subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
We are going to discuss a series of topic today. So I thought of taking up gut microbiota and human health as a series to explain in three parts. So in the first part of this column, we will be discussing about gut microbiota, obesity, diabetes, and heart health. As Hippocrates said almost 1,000 years back, that all diseases begin in the gut. It's time we redefine our relationship with the gut microbiota. Gut health is the key to overall health. Every food and meal we eat influences the bacteria present in our gut for a better or a worse outcome. A human body houses trillions of microorganisms or gut flora. In a recent study, Ron Sander and colleagues estimated that the number of bacteria in the human body is same as the number of human cells, and their total mass is about 0.2 kg, that is 500 grams. Almost 1,000 species of bacteria live in the human gut, and each one of them plays a crucial role in our body. Microbes in our gut weigh 1 to 2 kg, carry more than 154 genes than the human genome itself, and weighs almost like the brain. Gut microbiota thus functions as a second brain. We sometimes call them, organ within an organ, right? So this entire mechanism functions like an extra organ in executing multiple functions in our body. Now, almost 10,000 species of bacteria are working every day. But before we get into the conversation, I would like you to know the concept of dysbiosis. It's very important for us to understand the relationship between gut microbiota and metabolic syndromes such as obesity, diabetes type 2, and the concept of dysbiosis needs to be discussed. So according to the textbook, Nature Medicine in 2020, dysbiosis can be defined as a reduction in microbial diversity and a combination of the loss of beneficial bacteria such as bacterioid strain and butyrate producing bacteria such as Firmicutes 10 and rise in Pathobionts 12. This process basically disharmonizing the symbiotic nature between or symbiotic relationship between the good bacteria and the bad bacteria. Simply put, dysbiosis is the condition where harmful gut microbiota outnumbers beneficial bacteria and lead to several disease outcomes. So when we look at obesity, diabetes, and gut connection, a pile of original research studies, meta-analysis, comprehensive reviews compelled the researchers to register the huge contribution of gut microbiota towards health and disease outcome. Multiple studies have found that endotoxin, which is a bacterial waste product, leaks through the gut lining and enters the bloodstream, causing metabolic endotoxemia. Now, these endotoxins, which are released by the gut microbiota, are countered by the body's immune system because they are almost perceived as foreign material by the body. This leads to an autoimmune response and low-grade systematic inflammation that is linked to obesity. Gut flora balance is linked to weight gain, obesity, and type 2 diabetes. Diet shapes gut microbiota, and gut microbiota shapes obesity. Now, Ellen Peterson explains this concept in a comprehensive review. The authors here mentioned metabolic endotoxemia has considerable effects on host adiposity and insulin resistance. They said the lack of symbiosis between healthy and unhealthy gut microbiota, which is also known as dysbiosis, as we have learned in the earlier section, may contribute to weight gain. So it's not only as simple as eating calories, more calories or excess calories and not physically being active. It's way, way more complex than we used to think. So the gut microbiota, what you have inside your stomach, is extremely, extremely important to decide the adiposity or weight accumulation in your body. A 2019 review cited multiple studies that reported that 90% of all type 2 diabetes cases worldwide is due to microbiome dysbiosis, including insulin resistance, right? So 90% of type 2 diabetes here in worldwide are found to be connected to the microbiome dysbiosis. So that's a huge revelation, I would say, a great data perspective. A Lancet summary, Lancet is a very reputed medical journal, as we all know, of 42 human studies. So Lancet collated and analyzed 42 human studies reporting microbial connection with disease-induced or disease-identified the bacteria colony of Bifidobacterium, bacteroids, and then other negatively associated with type 2 diabetes. So these, some bacteria they found and identified were negatively associated with type 2 diabetes. On the other hand, there were other bacterial colonies like Bacturia and Fusobacterium, which were associated to type 2 disease, type 2 diabetes disease occurrence and progression. So this Lancet study found that there are colonies of bacteria which are helping to prevent insulin-induced type 2 diabetes. And then there are other colonies which are actually promoting that. Now, this is truly intriguing to understand that it's not only the sugar and sugar food, what you eat, but it's also how those food actually interplay or interconnected or change the entire bacterial colony inside your gut. When we discuss about heart health and gut, it has to be explained from a point of view that trimethylamine N-oxide or TMAO is a metabolite produced by some gut microbiota, is a potential biomarker of poor cardiovascular outcomes in patients living with heart diseases. Now, a review by the researchers from the University of Cambridge explained some gut microbiota convert choline, which is a nutrient found from red meat and legumes, into trimethylamine, that is TMA, which again gets converted into TMAO or trimethyl N-oxide, which is much more harmful version of TMA, which is practically a toxin, we can say. So choline and similarly L-carnitine, which we find from which we can find in red meat and legumes, are being converted into a toxin chemical, which is known as TMAO, when it's by certain gut microbiota. This altogether increases the risk of atherosclerosis, which is a condition of heart that occurs when plaque accumulated inside your arteries. Also, they are affecting the overall heart health. How refined sugar and fat affects our gut flora? Because we keep on hearing this, that if you are taking trans fatty acid food and if you're taking a lot of sugar, so how does that actually affect? Because our diet is everything. Our diet is shaping the symbiosis, shaping the amount, the nature, the disease outcome, everything. If you are feeding yourself bad food, then these good microbiota will die eventually, and the number of pathogens or bad bacteria will increase in our gut. Now, combination of high fat food, high trans fatty acid food, not high fat, high refined carbs, low dietary fiber diets lead to alteration in gut microbial composition linked to harmful metabolic health outcome. So as we can see in a 2021 review, which is very recent, concluded overconsumption of sucrose or table sugar, the white sugar which we usually use, has more deleterious effects on metabolic alterations. Fructose, a sugar we find from honey, fruits, fruits, they also affect the gut barrier function and leads to subclinical inflammation and overall contribution to fat accumulation. But here, when it comes to fructose and sucrose, we need to remember that every component of these are actually sugar, and we need to treat carefully. A study conducted by Yale University and National Institute of Health reported that high intake of both sucrose and fructose, it's not only the table sugar, two different forms of simple sugar were associated with compromised function of gut microbiota in lean and healthy people. It's not that they were obese. So here we understand the importance of microbiota as a whole. Higher consumption of sugar also leads to leaky gut syndrome, which we have learned earlier. So increases the number of pathogenic bacteria, eliminates beneficial bacteria, and promotes inflammation. So typical Western diet that contains multiple ultra-processed foods, and now these foods also invaded Indian food plate, that are loaded with refined carbs, trans fatty acids, and preservatives, are basically the problem. These diets disturb the balance between good and bad bacterial culture in our guts, change their composition, and lead to inflammation. So what do we conclude from here, from the first part of this series? Gut microbiota functions like an organ within an organ. Emerging evidence sheds light on the complex mechanism of action between gut microbiota diet and disease manifestation that need attention. A diverse whole food-based probiotic diet is recommended to keep the gut microbiota healthy to long run. Now in part two and part three, we will be discussing the importance or the role of gut microbiota on mental or brain health, for example, mood and anxiety and depression. And gut microbiota, in part three, we will discuss gut microbiota and immune system, right? And also in part three, I will be giving the detailed dietary guidelines as well. With that, thank you very much. Let's enjoy.